CinemaJaw is brought to you by Cards Against Humanity. They asked us not to read an ad. Enjoy the show. You're listening to CinemaJaw, the greatest movies podcast ever, recorded on Division Street in Chicago. My name is Matt Kay, and with me is...
Rye the Movie Guy. And sitting alongside us, as always, is our engineer and local filmmaker, Elias Rodriguez.
How's it going, Jawheads?
This week on CinemaJaw, Matt, we get addicted. We get addicted to a lot of things. We get addicted to movies as we talk our top five favorite movies about addiction.
Yeah, and you know what? We should say this at the top of the show. We like to make light of things here on CinemaJaw, but this is a serious topic.
Oh, there's no doubt about it. And there's a lot of reasons why I love cinema, right? Entertainment, you learn things. And also, I find cinema to be able to cope with some issues. And I think when it comes to addiction, it shed a light on a lot of things. And I think we're going to touch on some of those movies tonight.
Cool. Well said.
We're doing this in honor of a great guest who's going to be joining us and is in a movie itself dealing with alcohol and drug addiction.
Yeah, very excited to talk to Krisha Fairchild from the movie Krisha, who will be joining us shortly.
Yeah, it's awesome because, you know, just 2 weeks ago, we were talking our favorite movies of 2016, and Krisha came up both on... You know, not on my top 10. It was just outside of my top 10, but I loved it so much. And to think, like, this is such an honor. We're actually going to be able to talk to Krisha in a couple of seconds.
Very cool.
Yeah. We just don't stop there. You know what I mean? We got a jam.
Why would we?
No, absolutely not, man. We got a jam-packed jaw, don't we, Elias?
Oh, yeah. We are going eye for an eye on Gold.
And we have a review of M. Night Shyamalan's latest Split.
Yes. And in honor of that new Matthew McConaughey film, Gold, I thought, what better time than to play a little Matthew McConaughey movie trivia yourself first, Krisha?
All right.
I like it. And it's also interesting. We were reading Krisha's bio and getting to know her before the interview. And one of the things that is on there is she is a self-proclaimed hippie.
Yeah.
Which is awesome. And it got me thinking. I think we both can agree, because I know we've talked about this movie numerous times on CinemaJaw, Matt. There is one movie hippie above all other movie hippies, is there not?
There sure is, man.
Finally, we agree on something, right?
When are people going to see through this farce?
I know, but they love it. Every week, I'm sure they chuckle at this.
They do.
There's no doubt the best movie hippie of all time is...
Tommy Chong.
No, the dude.
Tommy Chong.
It's the dude,
it's
Jeff
Chong.
Bridges. Oh, you got to be kidding me. What are you smoking over there?
I'm smoking the right stuff.
CinemaWAR. Ooh, Krisha's going to have her hands full right there.
Yes.
Yes. It is a jam-packed jaw, Matt. As I said, I told you.
As always.
Does it get any better than this?
No.
Without further ado, as I mentioned, the film Krisha, and I want to say this right at the top, and I know we're going to talk about the movie here momentarily, but again, to all the jawheads, especially here in the United States, it's streaming on Amazon Prime. I urge everyone to check this movie out. It is one of the very best films of 2016. It has landed on many a top 10 lists, from John Waters to Dana Stevens of Slate Magazine and Screen Crush, and a lot has to do with the actress who is joining us right now, Krisha Fairchild. Welcome to CinemaJaw.
Thank you.
You sound so nice over there, Krisha. And it should be noted you are calling us from down in Mexico.
I am. Yeah, it's amazing the technology now. The whole tin can and the string thing. We don't have to do that anymore.
No.
I mean, it seriously sounds like you're in the next room or even this room. It's great.
Okay, I am. Surprise, I'm going to come through the door and he's like, no, I'm in central Mexico and loving it. I'm retired here.
Oh, that has got to be heaven. But we were talking right before we started recording that you're actually a Chicago native and not unfamiliar with Division Street.
No, not at all. Yeah, I actually went to Chicago to go to the Art Institute of Chicago back in the day when the Goodman Theater School was a part of the Art Institute. And so it was like early 70s. And yeah, I'm 66. So my old days are, you weren't a glimmer during my old days. And I had a summer job working at Butch McGuire's as a waitress.
That is crazy. Do you remember any of the people from back then? Because I tell you, believe it or not, I'm sure some of them are still here. I'll mention you said hi.
I am sure that they are. The things I remember the most from Butch McGuire's, to be honest, were hollandaise sauce stains up both arms of my shirts always.
Oh, those eggs Benedict are still killer over there, by the way.
Absolutely. And I remember that I insisted on bringing up the kegs of Guinness when they ran out, which meant a trip to the basement and rolling the keg through the bar and the whole thing. I was this very matcha young woman, and I was like, no, I got it.
So were you doing some acting at that time in Chicago, Krisha?
Yeah, actually, I was in the very first production of the Wisdom Bridge Theater. And well, Michael Cullen, he ended up opening up a complex of theaters there, right?
Sure.
Yeah.
And so that was one of his, and I was in this little theater company called the Travel Light Theater Company. And we did pub theater. We did like Pinter and Ionesco and Albee and people like that in bars.
Wow.
Which was quite the experience.
Yeah. I bet.
Was this during like the week when it was a smaller bar crowd, or were people packed bars? Or
you know, we did it kind of all over. And before people got too drunk, they were actually appreciative and attentive. And then after that, it was like you hoped that you were in the part of the play where the heckling could be brought in. It was improv. It really was like a very pure form of improv. Only the people were slightly too hugely inebriated.
That sounds about like Chicago. Yeah,
it makes for a fun night. That sounds awesome.
Improv and inebriated,
It was some of the most challenging theater that I ever did. And I did theater at the Goodman, because you do when you're getting your degree, and I loved it. I was in my first independent film. It was called Stony Island, and it was directed by Andrew Davis, the guy who directed The Fugitive later, and shot by Tak Fujimoto, and at his first big movie as a cinematographer. And after we did it, they asked me to come out to L.A. with them, and that was the invite I was looking for. So I packed my Carmen Ghia and hit the road.
It's an exciting time when you get that call, when you get into a film, when it's probably something that you had sort of strided for all that time, you know, working in Chicago. Probably exciting time going out to L.A.
Yeah, it definitely was. But the problem was that I was the assistant to the producer and the production secretary also, as well as acting in it. And once I got out there, my job was to throw away all the headshots from all the actors.
Oh man, how disheartening is that?
It was totally, I mean, I only stayed in LA about 11 years then. It sounds
only
like a long
11
time
years,
to you,
yeah.
But in LA, that was a blink. And it was because I lost the thread of what an actor's value was in the production from working on the production side.
Yeah.
It sounds horrible, but that's what happened.
So that takes us into, was it like the 1990s? I noticed on your IMDb page, you started getting some projects and some voice work as well. Were you also out in LA at that point? Or
no, you know, that's so funny. It's like LA just did not work for me. I wasn't pretty enough. I wasn't slender enough. They didn't know what to do with me. And so I ended up going to a wedding of a friend who's going to be visiting me here within a week in Mexico, in Seattle. And I go up to Seattle, and like everybody there is like, well, you know, I work at Boeing, but I'm really a jazz musician.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, everybody was so interesting, and they weren't just in the one business. So I moved to Seattle and I became a voice actor in 1988. And I've supported myself entirely by doing narration and commercials and voice acting since then. And then while I was up there, I started getting cast in movies and TV shows.
Yeah, one in particular jumped out at me as I was looking through your bio. You were actually on Northern Exposure.
I was in two different episodes. I was in the one where they go back in time and to the founding of the city. I was the school marm holding an axe when we were being threatened. And that was quite an interesting experience. I'll just tell you one little anecdote
about
being a bit actor on a leading TV show. It was, you know, at the top of the pile right then. There was a scene we were doing in a bar, and you know, the art direction was just fabulous for those episodes. And so we're all in this bar, and they're smoking the bar, you know, because everybody's smoking and they've got the bar all smoky. Mm-hmm. And I look over, and Rob Morrow and Janine Turner, is that her name?
Yeah. Yes.
And they're standing just off of the set wearing like gas masks.
Really?
And we're on the set for many hours without any masks. And it just gives you a little bit of pause. You kind of go, I think I want to be the one with the mask.
That has got to be such an odd predicament to find yourself in. That is weird.
It was, but it was fun. I also sassed John Corbett in that scene, and kind of called him out on some stuff. And as we got on the bus to go back, I thought, you know, oh, they're going to fire me. And instead, like the cinematographer, all the people coming along, go, thank you so much. Oh my, thank you so much. He had a habit of kind of messing around when he wasn't on camera. When he was supposed to be in your reverse shot, he would like speak gibberish to you and you were supposed to respond. And, you know, I wasn't important enough to need to protect my job. So I kind of like called him on it and made fun of him. And I got a good laugh and a big applause. But he never spoke to me again after
that. That was it.
It's his loss, Krisha. It's his loss.
Oh, that's good stuff. I think it's so ironic that here you were in Los Angeles for 11 years, and it's when you make the move to Seattle where your career as an actress blooms. I love that kind of stuff.
Yeah, me too.
So that brings us to Krisha, and this is a film that should be noted. It's directed by your nephew, Trey Edward Schultz. How does he come about approaching you to star in the film first? Does he have an idea of casting you and approach you that way? Or is this something that he had and you sort of noticed he was working on and wanted to be involved in?
Well, the whole thing actually started when he was six. I had a lot of preparation for it. He was watching Batman movies and comparing the directorial style.
Oh,
you know,
okay. Yeah.
When he was just a wee boy.
Yeah, a precocious lad.
Yeah, and so I felt that if I just bide my time, eventually he will write something for me to play. And meanwhile, you know, he sees me in things and he sees the videos of the things, and then he starts making little home movies when he was maybe 10. I was in his very first film ever. I played an IRS agent who shows up at the door of a house with a briefcase and glasses and very like in a business suity kind of like straight woman thing. And he and his three buddies, who were like gangsters and they're like swearing every other word is a curse word, answer the door and start shooting at me. And I run away and you see a scene of me running across a field, flapping my briefcase and everything. And they shoot me down in the field. And in the next scene, they have stuffed my body into a huge suitcase and they are dragging my body up a flight of stairs to an attic. So, hand to God, that was my first Trey Edward Schultz joint. That was my first role in this movie.
I'd like to see that maybe put on an extra of a DVD. You know, I'd like to see that.
I'm pretty sure that he has destroyed all evidence of all of this. But what he did start doing when he was like 18, I was raising my niece, his cousin. Her name is Nika. She was the golden child in the family. She was Mensa smart. She was an amazing, amazing human being. And someone put a needle in her arm when she was 14 backstage at a concert. Mm. And from that moment on, Trey, who had admired her like unbelievably, and all of us who had loved her completely unconditionally, our whole lives changed, as will happen when someone in your family is struggling to get clear of an addiction and you're trying to help them. And he quickly kind of grew up. His own father had been an addict and he had seen things that a child shouldn't see. And I was, when Nika finally went off the rails to a point where we had to take her children from her, I was raising her oldest son and I was living in Hawaii doing this. And Trey started coming summers and spending summers there to be a mentor for this kid and just to be a part of our lives. And he started to make a couple short movies that were about grief. And I was surprised at that choice for a very young filmmaker. One of the summers, my red dog, she was a red cow dog, and she was woke up one morning dying. And Trey picked up his camera and he followed me around that day as I tried to decide what to do. And I tried to get her on her feet and he has all this footage of me sitting with my feet in her bed, rocking my chair and crying and trying to think, you know, the vet says, bring her it's time for her to go, you know, bring her. And he rode in the back of the car. He helped me get the dog in the car. And he has footage of her sticking her head out the window and her ears waffling in the wind. And then he photographed me leaving the vet's office alone. And I just kind of, he was following me around. I wasn't paying attention. I was with my dog, you know, mm-hmm. And he made it into the most amazing little short that just tears people apart when they see it. And so I knew then that he was not going to be jumping into trying to make Ninja Turtle movies, the kind of movies he loved as a kid. I got that life had affected him in such a way that he wanted to address the real things in life. So after the two shorts, we had a Christmas where Nika showed up and she'd been 5 years sober. And she was there, and I had brought Israel, you know, to get to see her. And she was off the rails. She was stealing from us. She was sneaking out of the window to go to bars. It was the most horrible experience. And we were trying to protect this child who was a young teenager. And we had a reunion where it was just like, we were all excruciated at our inability to just shake her and say, stop this. Your child is seeing this. Get a hold of yourself. And because we loved her so much, we would do anything. And Trey observed that. Mm. And 2 months later, she died of an overdose. Ah. And Trey wrote. He just went into a room and wrote. And he sent it to me to read. And I had no idea he wanted me to play that role, the role of the addict, because I'm the opposite in our family. I'm the middle child. I'm the mediator. I'm the one who fixes everything. I'm the peacemaker. I'm
the stable one.
Yes. And he wanted me to play the addict, to represent my mother, who was an alcoholic, his father, who was an addict and an alcoholic, and Nika. And, there was never any question that I had to try to do it, but I was scared. I was very frightened. I hadn't put my teeth in anything like that, you know, since acting school, you know, long time.
Sure.
I don't know if you know this part of the story, but I think young filmmakers will find this interesting. He decided he was going to make it as a feature, and he was going to make it with the family. And he had been working, you know, for Terrence Malick. He had been traveling the world on one of Terrence Malick's crews.
Wow.
That's another great story. I hooked him up with some friends in Hawaii, thinking he was going to be a gopher on a set.
Uh-huh.
And he, in the course of like two different shoot days, the next thing I know, he is leaving in a helicopter to be on the lava on the Big Island, where they're shooting footage for Terrence Malick's.
Wow.
The movie that's about the beginning of the world.
Tree of Life.
It just came out recently.
Yeah. The one about like the universe and all that good stuff.
Yeah. Sure. And then the next thing I know, he's going to Chile, and he's in and he's all over the world with this Terrence Malick movie, and so now he's saved this money from working as a crew person, and he wants to make a feature in 8 days, and we all said, of course, yes, because what do you say to a child who's, he was 20, I think 24 when he wrote this short, maybe even a little younger. And he'd lived through everything with us of this, and it was an incredibly perceptive script. There's a moment, and I don't know if any of you have addiction in your family.
Sure.
There's a moment when you realize that for all of the whispering and all of the kids, you go on in there and you know, everything is fine. Mommy's just a little. And for all of that, that the family has done, children are not stupid.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
They vibe what is going on everywhere that they are. And he had vibed all this and then written this incredible fly on a wall script, the script for what became the short, the first attempt at the feature. It was so much like the script of the feature that you saw. You wouldn't even believe it. And we all got together and we started shooting. He had no light, only available light and room light. He didn't have a budget for light gear. And we woke up one day when we had to match a scene, a major scene, and it was raining.
Oh, man.
Trey disappeared into his parents' bedroom. I only tell this because he tells it on himself in Q&As. He had a little nervous breakdown. He suddenly began to feel, for the first time, foolish to have dreamed that he could do this on so little money. $16,000 was his budget. And his parents are both therapists. And they came into the room with him and they let him cry it out. And then they just said, well, what can you do with the days you have left and the money you've already invested? And he said, I could make a short. And they said, that's a plan. So he pulled himself together and he went back out to where everybody was and he got us back onto shooting. We shot the whole feature as written. He took 2 years to edit it down into a short. And when he showed it at South By, we won a special jury award for it. And then the next thing you know, we're in all these festivals and we're winning festivals left and right with the short. Mm-hmm. His best friend since second grade, Justin Chan, who is one of his producers on that, on our film and also on the next film where he had significantly more money. A24 just funded the movie he's finishing right now. And Justin came to him after all the festivals and everything and said, well, it seems to me like there's some buzz going on. This would be a good time to raise the money to do the feature. Mm-hmm. And Trey's like, oh my God, man, do you think we can? And Justin's like, well, of course we can. And that was March that we played in South By with the short the first time. August 1st, we began to shoot the feature. And this time it took 9 days.
Mm-hmm. August 1st of which year now?
2014.
Okay. All right. Just trying to get the timeline.
So actually, the feature ended up being in South By exactly 1 year after the short had been there.
That's amazing.
Wow.
It was a pretty amazing experience. And I am so grateful for having been on all of it. It was a do-over in all the best ways. The cinematographer was the same guy. The music was the same guy. The actors were the same. He was able to bring in a few professional actors. Doyle, the comedic genius who plays his uncle, you know, that the guy who just tears into me in those scenes.
Yeah, yeah. Out of that
100-degree Texas heat. That was an improv. 2 20-minute-long improvs. And in one, he was nice as pie, and in the other one, he took my head off. And he's brilliant. So this time, Trey had the chops and the confidence, and he started it with $30,000 this time. Mm-hmm. And we shot it in 9 days, and the feeling on the set was that something really special had happened in that we had all become a family while we were shooting it.
And I was going to ask when that sort of happened, because on a project like this, I think there's a moment where you know, wow, this is something special that we're doing here.
Yeah. Well, I think most of the people said that when they were welcomed to the house, like family members, everyone stayed in the house. Okay, and I think there were actually 4 actors who had condos. It was in their contract that they had to have their own place. But all the crew, all the other people, I was the first one up every morning, so I made coffee for everybody. Trey's girlfriend, Ashley, and she flew her mother up from Florida because her mother's done catering. They made the meals for everyone. We all did our own hair, makeup, and wardrobe. We became a family because we lived like a family. After everything was shot for the day and we wrapped, the boys would go up to the room with the big screen TV. And the first night, I think they watched The Shining. Mm-hmm. You know,
that's awesome.
And they would just pick a movie every night. And then some nights, Bill Wise, the guy who played Doyle, would be there and he would just be cracking them up. And then they would all finally just pass out where they lay. And I would usually get up from my room and come tiptoe in and turn the movie off and throw little blankies over everybody and turn the lights. It was, we lived like a family and it absolutely told on the screen. You see it there. You see the comfort that we all had with each other.
Yeah. I have a couple of questions. First of all, this is so rare that you have a film like this that is made pretty much entirely by one family. I mean, like, you guys are like the modern day Von Trapps or something, where you've all got this tremendous talent to come together as one cohesive unit and become a film cast and crew and put out this amazing piece of work. Do you see that happening again from you guys? We're all with all the same, we're many of the same collaborators. I mean, certainly.
Well, I will say this, his second film where he had a lot more money, he had the same three producers that were his friends who were learning on the job. They had an executive producer over them. So they were, you know, they were definitely learning. He used the same DP. He's using the same composer for the score. The actors in this story, which he had written, the script was completed before Krisha, anyone ever saw Krisha, were not any of us because they could not be. The story did not require it. There's buzz about the third movie that Robin and I are going to be in it. Not certain. You know, it's like you can never go back and make the same magic happen.
Yeah.
If we ever did this again, it would be a completely different magic. But I can tell you from my standpoint, my little sister, his mother, Robin, who played those heartbreaking scenes with me, mm-hmm. she's not an actress. She's a therapist. She's one of the best actresses I've ever worked with. And I would kill to work with her again. I'm sure we'll make something together again. But the world has shifted now. Trey's a made man.
Yeah, I think you're right. He's definitely got a future. And kind of brings me to my next question. I mean, I think one of the talents that I saw in this movie, I mean, there's a lot of talent to be seen here, but the film, what he's able to do is it's just so human. A lot of times when you see independent films, it's like the director's sort of playing house and he shows you things that we hope people do or we think people do, but not so, it's just so human. We see in Krisha what people are really like. You know, it's natural. And my question is, how did he get those performances out of you guys? Where, I mean, none of, aside from yourself, most of the cast, and with a couple exceptions, were not trained actors, like you mentioned. So how did he do that?
They were aspiring actors, several of them.
Okay.
All the young group, the two brothers and the sister. Mm-hmm. Aspiring actors. They're all working right now. You know, I think all three of them moved to Los Angeles. They may be back. Some of them may be back in Austin, but they're working in Austin and LA right now. How did he do it? Well, first of all, he didn't over rehearse us, but he made sure that we were rehearsed enough to feel comfortable and confident. He was not a Nazi about the language. He allowed us to bring in the same way that he allowed us to create the physical character that we were playing by bringing the clothes that we thought they would be wearing and styling our hair in the way that we, you know, he also allowed us to come up with their bios within the small framework that he gave us in the script of, you know, how we were related. The relationships, they weren't in the script. That was for us to find. He encouraged us to improv. We went off and improvised things. Robin and Chris, Chris Dubeck, who's like a fantastic method actor. And here's this actress who isn't an actress and a very serious method actor. They're supposed to have been married for 20-something years. And they accomplished that by going into the dining room and closing themselves up and ironing together. They were both ironing their wardrobe.
Yeah.
and they talked for hours. Every time you looked around, where are they? They're head to head. They're talking. They were sharing life stories. They were sharing anecdotes from Trey's childhood. You know, she was definitely infusing for Chris the fatherhood that he would have experienced with Trey, you know?
Sure.
And so that's the best thing that I can say is that he allowed us the freedom to bring, and then he was very careful how he spoke to us and always supportive.
Wonderful. And I did want to ask, because this was such a personal movie, was there a time during that 9-day shoot where it was just overbearing, maybe a moment where it was almost a little bit too much, where you guys almost had to take a breather from the shoot?
No, you know, but the reason why is that there were a lot of loving arms. When you think about it, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I would walk out of a scene where I'd just been supposedly, you know, self-destructing in a bathroom. It's 2 a.m. And we're shooting those scenes at night so that everybody else can get a night's sleep. Oh, I'm going to cry again. I walked out of that scene And I was sleeping in my little sister's bedroom. We were sharing her bedroom. She sent her husband to see to visit his mother. We ran baths for each other. We gave each other back rubs. We were sharing a bed. We were sharing life so that we remembered how much we love each other. So that when we had to hurt each other, the love immediately, the next thing after cut was tears and hugs.
Ah, yeah. And
the very next thing mm-hmm. after cut, someone was there to support you. This was very difficult for my older sister, who was the mother of Nika. Mm-hmm. And there was not a scene that she was in that when cut happened, one of the children who was supposed to be one of her children had their arms around her. And that's, there was never a moment when it became too much, because most of my dark night of the soul was happening in the dark night, and I was alone mm-hmm. in a bathroom with some guys who for some reason were there and they had cameras.
Yeah. And those scenes, honestly, Krisha, were terrifying. I mean, they were very effective watching it. It was gripping seeing it all unfold in the story. And of course, anyone who has seen the movie, and again, if you hadn't, please do stream it. The ending scene, it is one of the more talked about scenes, I think, of 2016, as this sort of boils to this climactic moment. Please tell me that was done in one take. I want to know about that last scene.
Well, first I'll tell you what happened before that take. And that is that I had to go upstairs into a room by myself. They brought me I don't drink. So they brought me like a finger of scotch in a little glass. Mm-hmm. I had downloaded Bob Dylan's Like a Rolling Stone, which is like, to me, an anthem of self-pity and anger and all of the things that that an addict on the way down in a meltdown phase is going to be thinking, you know, like, you fuck me over. This isn't my fault. This is once upon a time. You know, I mean, it's just mm-hmm. like, bleh. And I was up in that room and I would tap the scotch against my lips so I could get that horrible taste in my mouth that she would have been so hungry for. And I sang at the top of my lungs to that anthem of self-pity. And when I got cranked enough to go down and do it, they were just, what their instructions were, have a good time. And then when I came in like a tornado. The first take, actually, I was, we misunderstood something, and she was trying to move me off of my dime, and I just slammed her up against a wall.
Wow.
And then we all had to regroup, uh-huh. and it was like, okay, now that was good. We got that out of the way. Now let's use our technique and not hurt each other. Yeah. So it was, no, we did several takes of it. The take that he used was mostly one take. Yes.
Wow. It was so moving. I remember sitting there. I streamed this one at home, and it was one of those moments, I think, where the film ended and I had a tear in my eye and my mouth was just open. I was like in shock and saddened. Talk about an effective movie. I mean, this thing hit me like a brick, man.
Yeah. I can say this. I feel he has a real deep gift.
I think that's clear. Absolutely. Yeah.
So let's talk about the success of the film. As you mentioned, it comes out at South by, and I guess what would you say at that point? It was almost like a locomotive. It was just started to go. And I remember hearing about it. You know, we obviously do this show in and out every single week, and we have a lot of critic friends. And I remember one of them had saw it early, and I already had saw like a tweet and buzz about it. Sort of take us from the success of when it comes out to South by to what it is today, where people are listening in on top tens and all the accolades that have come along with it.
Well, of course, the first thing you need to know is that when we went to South by, we had absolutely zero idea that any of this was about to happen. Mm-hmm. We were staying in the cheapest motel you could find. You know, I mean, we Robin and I were supposed to go back after just one screening. You know, that it completely overwhelmed us. The other piece of it that I need to share with you is that after our first screening, we got a call from a publicist in New York. We didn't have any of that stuff. We didn't have money for it. Who volunteered to help us get some people in to see the movie because of what he had heard about it. His name is Adam Kirsch with Brigade Marketing, and he is one of the angels on our team. He got critics to the second screening. The second screening was the only, we had only had two screenings before the awards. During the second screening, Justin and Jonathan Chan, the two producers on the movie who have been friends with Trey since second grade, got up and left the screening and said to me, there's a family emergency. Ooh. Well, they're our family. And mm-hmm. we did the Q&A, and when the Q&A was over, Trey's on the phone to them. The night that we won South By, their mother had been hit by a drunk driver.
Oh my God.
And she was in a coma in Houston, and they had to go and say goodbye to their mother. Huh. That's the night that we won the movie. The two people that absolutely the movie would have never been made without, besides Trey. The three of them were the key thing. So we were a little, it was weird, the sure. winning of the award, because it was a bittersweet, very bittersweet moment.
Sure.
And no one knew us. So we looked out at this sea of crossed arms and kind of pissy faces, you know, and then we were all ready to disperse. And then we get a call, no, you need to stay a couple more days. What is that about? And then we won the audience award, which really rarely happens that you yeah. win the jury award. Any.
Yeah.
And the audience award. So by the time we parted, we had on the way, in the car on the way there, I forgot to tell you this, Robin had said to Trey, okay, so son, do you have like are you visualizing, you know, what it is that you would like to take away from this experience? And he said, yeah. And she said, would you want to share that with us? And he said, yeah, I am, the best case scenario would be that I would get the attention of a distributor. And Robin said, and do you have one in mind? He went, well, I do, but I mean, I can't, that would never happen. They're my dream, and that's never going to happen. And she said, who's that? And he said, A24. And it was the first time we ever heard of them, Robin and I, because we're not, you know. Sure. And of course, that is who picked up the movie. Mm-hmm. They got wind of it. They asked to see what he had in the trunk. And what he had in the trunk was It Comes at Night, which is a horror film.
Yeah.
And that's the one they're finishing editing and starting this score to right now. It comes out later this year. I'm not allowed to say anything more than that.
I'm kind of glad to hear that he's working in horror, because there's some elements of that in Krisha.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, but that's...
No, not at all. So I'll try to make it quicker. The next thing that happened is that someone who had seen the movie got a hold of Cannes, even though it was too late for the competition, but it was only too late by, like, you know, 10 hours or whatever. And we sent it off to Samantha Critique, and we got in. And then that was when we were all like, okay, this is Tiger by the Tail time. We didn't expect any of this. None of us. You know, I had to buy, you know, foundation garments, you know, for God's sake. You know, it was like, Robin's like, I don't even own any heels or a dress. And I'm like, you know, so we went to Cannes, and again, this is so Trey. He borrowed money so that he could buy our airfare and rent an apartment so that everybody in the cast that could take the time off could go to Cannes. And because we never thought anything more was going to come of it than that. It was like, woo, last party. So at Cannes, they announced, A24 announced that not only had they bought Krisha and were going to give it a theatrical release, but they had made it a two-picture deal and they'd bought his second script. Wow. So that's when it really started to get cuckoo. We won a festival in Italy that I had never even heard of, but Variety had submitted us as one of their picks of one of the best movies, and we win the thing. Susan Sarandon accepted our award.
Wow.
Because we weren't there. And yeah, he won, I'm not going to be able to think of Deauville. I don't want to say wrong, but he was like just all over everywhere. We all went to London for BFI. And then in last February, again, against all odds, we won the Cassavetes Award at the Independent Spirits. We walk into every room we walk into. Nobody knows who we are. Nobody knows who we are. They don't recognize it. I'm pretty recognizable. People don't recognize me. They've not seen the movie. It's still kind of that way. You know, we hadn't had our distribution, our theatrical release in February. So literally nobody knew who we were, except the people who did. And they were so sweet and wonderful to us. And we won that. And then we thought, okay, that's it. That's all that's going to happen. And then it just keeps rolling. I just came back from LA for the LA Critics. You know, he won the New York Critics
first feature.
And then the LA Critics. And now when I walk into a room, people have seen the movie. Mm-hmm. And that's a complete and utter shift, but it took almost exactly 2 years to happen.
Yeah.
Isn't that crazy?
What an amazing story. That's a hell of a journey.
It really is. But I think going to the heart of like doing the podcast that me and Matt do every week, and Elias, we talk about these movies all the time. And I know when I saw it, I came on here and spread the word, right? You see a great movie like that. And I think the reason it is having such success is it hits something that a lot of families do have struggles with.
Yes.
And my family, no exception. So I think it was something that I watched and could relate to. And I don't think I've ever seen a movie where I could relate to it in that way, that honest way. Yeah. And there was something that was almost comforting. That may almost sound weird, but there was almost something that was struck me hard. But at the same time, it was comforting to know that there are other families going through the same thing. And I think that's sometimes what cinema does for us, you know?
I will tell you, from the very first screening in South By, what people want immediately after seeing our movie is to either be comforted by us or to comfort us. It is a hugging crowd. People come to the front after the Q&A, and you can tell by who they need to hug. What their story is, literally. If they're hugging my older sister whose child died, well, that's their story too. Mm-hmm. If they're hugging my younger sister who had to tough love, that's their story. If they're hugging me, they're almost always telling me exactly to the day how long they've been sober.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And if they're going to tray, they want to know about the aspect ratio.
Yeah.
But it is comforting because everyone feels alone when it's the elephant in everybody's living room. Mm-hmm. When there are a million different ways to deal with loving an addict, and none of them are wrong, and all of them may be right or may be wrong, and you don't know until you try them. You know, everyone, I've had alcoholics come up to me and say, I never understood what my family was feeling when I was doing this. Mm-hmm. And I've had families come up to me and say, I never understood what our addict was feeling. Trey created a character, and then I brought her to life, who is an empathetic anti-hero.
It's true.
You have empathy for her.
Yeah,
sure.
But she's messing up.
You want her to do well, though. Yeah.
Yes, you do.
And
yes.
Krisha, now we've talked about Trey's success and happy that we are highlighting Trey and very excited for his career. But we are also very excited, Krisha, to hear what is next on your plate. This had to open up some doors and some opportunities that you got to be very excited about.
You know, you would think so, wouldn't you?
Oh,
I'm an incredibly optimistic person, and I'm a very positive person. So all I can say is, somewhere there is a director I respect or a writer I respect right now writing a role for me.
Oh, I would hope so.
But thus far, I have not been able to get an agent in Los Angeles. And that's kind of crazy. I have a manager who was a friend of a friend who came on board and said, he's been 35 years a high ticket agent and manager in Los Angeles. And he's like, I'm here for you. What do you need? I'm here to help you. What do you need? And he's been marshaling me through this, and he's been contacting people. And what he hears is that there are a lot of really wonderful actresses my age, and there aren't enough scripts.
Oh.
And so I'm waiting. I can tell you what I've turned down. I turned down a role as a victim, and there was nothing redeeming about her except that she was a victim. And the person who victimized her got away with it, didn't care for that. And I turned down a role where I was murdering children and torturing them.
Oh, wow. That sounded like a winner to me. I mean, why would you turn that down?
Yeah. You know, as my manager said to me, darling, you have a lot of years left. You can always pick up the knife later.
That's good advice, Krisha.
Good stuff. Well, Krisha, I, for one, will be very, very upset if Hollywood doesn't catch on and somebody, a writer, a director out there, get you in something soon. I was asking that question because I was excited. Just last week, we actually were wrapping up with our best performances of 2016, and I mentioned Krisha. So I'd be bummed if I don't get to see some more Krisha Fairchild.
Well, thank you. And I'd be bummed if I don't get to inhabit any more characters. I have a lot inside me, and I think that it's just a matter of time. I do have one director that I've talked to about a couple of projects. It's not that there's nothing. It's that it's just curious to me that there's nothing. Well, I mean, I'll never touch another role like this. I mean, how many of these come along, right?
Sure.
But I'm gonna give you something. I got two little independent features, actually. I have cameos in that are coming out in festivals this year. And both of them I did for friends and like little love projects. So, yeah, now you won't not see me. It may be a while before you see me really sink my teeth into something, but you will.
We're waiting for it.
I can't wait. Thank you. Yes. Now, again, for all the jawheads, we call our fans jawheads. For the jawheads that have not seen Krisha, again, one more time, it is streaming on Amazon Prime. If you don't have Amazon Prime, you can rent it at all the various sites. Throw that in the jaw box where it's streaming just to make sure.
Yeah.
So we get all that good stuff. And Krisha, anywhere to follow you on Twitter or Facebook in case some fans want to follow along?
Yes, absolutely. I just use my actual real name. Isn't that refreshing? It's just so strange. I think it's just Krisha Fairchild and Facebook the same. I'm kind of a real people.
Gotcha.
Not big on the social media.
Good stuff. Now, Krisha, we do like to end all of our guest interviews with some silly cinema cues, we call them. Get to know the guest through the eye of the lens. Elias, you got something for Krisha?
Yes, I do. And let's stress that these are silly. And I wrote these before this very amazing and honest and candid interview. So the first question is, so in Krisha, there's a big Thanksgiving dinner. If you had to spend a holiday dinner with one of these movie families, which one would you pick? The Torrance family from The Shining, or the Sawyer family from Texas Chainsaw Massacre?
Jeez.
Well, it's a lose-lose.
You know what? I've never seen Texas Chainsaw, although my friend John Dugan played the grandpa in it.
Wow.
So I think I would have to go have dinner with John.
Okay. There we go. Yeah, that works. And also, so you're a longtime voice actor. If you had the chance to redo the voice for any Disney character in history, which would you choose?
Oh, my goodness.
That's a good question, man.
Boy, it's a really good question. I am blanking because it would most certainly be a villain. You know, maybe one of the, you know, one of the bad stepmother witches, or, you know, evil woman who looks in the mirror and asks who's the most beautiful one.
Who's the woman in 101 Dalmatians?
Oh, God. Cruella de Vil. How could I have not thought of her? I'd have to dye half of my hair black. But okay. Yes. We'll go with that.
Great. Good answer. Thank you.
Awesome. Is that everything?
That's all.
Beautiful. All right. So Krisha is sitting in on this entire job. I mean, she has her top five favorite addiction movies, which is going to be interesting. Here, we did not limit this, mind you, to just drugs and alcohol. It can be any addiction, Matt, so you know.
Sure.
Just so you know. In case I go outside of the box on one or two.
You got a podcast addiction on your list?
I don't have podcast. Didn't go that far. It does bring us to a segment called Eye for an Eye, Interest or Ignore. Elias?
Yes, Eye for an Eye, Gold. Kenny Wells, a prospector desperate for a lucky break, teams up with a similarly eager geologist and sets off for an amazing journey to find gold in an uncharted jungle of Indonesia. Getting the gold was hard, but keeping it is even more difficult, sparking an adventure through the most powerful boardrooms of Wall Street. The film stars Matthew McConaughey and Bryce Dallas Howard. It's directed by Steven Gagan, who previously directed 2005's Syriana. We throw it over to Rye.
Saw the trailer for this, and you know, I've come around on my liking of the shirtless wonder, Matthew McConaughey, and it got me, you know, at first I thought, well, I might not be totally into this film. Could go either way. Could be one of those McConaughey bombs. I do like Syriana, and then I just today heard Matthew McConaughey on my buddy, Howard Stern. Great interview. And he was talking about how well he knows the character and the story and how he wanted to bring this to life. And he really sold me on it. I'm interested in Gold.
I pretty much fell asleep during Elias's synopsis of this. I am going to ignore Gold.
Wow, we throw it to Krisha. Krisha, interested or ignore on Gold?
Boy, God, you know, he's a good-looking guy, and so is she a gal. But that's not enough reason for me. I think I would go yawn.
Wow, two ignores, we throw it to Elias.
Yeah, I think on the topic, we're seeing a lot of these types of movies, and I'm going to ignore it.
Wow, three ignores. I'm the only one interested. But again, I was sold by the interview of Mr. McConaughey.
Yeah, I mean, he's a compelling dude. So it's got that going for it.
Yeah, speaking of new movies, Matt, M. Night Shyamalan is back. The man who gave us such great hits as The Sixth Sense and Unbreakable, but also such misfires as The Lady in the Water and The Happening, has audiences unsure if we can trust him. This time around, he calls on James McAvoy to help make sure he has a hit on his hands. Well, I hit the theater to see which M. Night we got.
What are we doing here? What the hell is going on?
I was sent to get you for a reason.
There's a flower on the pillows, a flower in the bathroom, like we're important.
The only chance we have is if all three of us go crazy on this guy.
Who is that? Maybe she can help us.
Don't worry. The beast is real.
He's done awful things to people, and he'll do awful things to you.
James McAvoy plays Kevin, a man suffering from having multiple personalities. The film opens with him taking three teenage girls hostage, locking them up in a basement room. He then slowly reveals all his different personalities to the girls. Some of them actually seem to want to help the girls. Other personalities want to be friends with them, but all of them warn of the monster coming for them. It is also revealed that McAvoy's character is seeing a psychologist, an elderly lady who thinks she has him all figured out, identifying 23 different personalities. However, his latest visits have her concerned that he is not well and that there may be a 24th side of him she has not seen. The film really rests here on the shoulders of McAvoy, and I will say he brings the goods. There are times he switches personas mid-conversation, and it is actually frightening. The story solely focuses on McAvoy. There is no real search going on for the girls. You hear a quick blurb of it on a newscast, but the focal point is always on McAvoy and his personalities. I felt this hindered the movie a little, as the scope was so small. Being an M. Night film, Matt, I was constantly searching for clues to see if I could find a twist coming. And to his credit, I did not find any major giveaway. Is this on the level of Sixth Sense? Nowhere even close. But the good news is, Matt, I didn't hate it. What would an M. Night film be without a nice reveal at the end? And this one will most certainly have people talking. Ride the Movie Guy's grade, a solid 2.5 Jaws.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sounds like the good M. Night showed up.
Definitely. As we had mentioned, The Visit was his prior film, which was a little bit like, what wouldn't you say, it was a little bit like a watered down M. Night, probably $5 million, $10 million budget, something much smaller. And I think that's the case here. You know, it's very much a one location shoot. It doesn't go too far outside of the main location where he has the girls locked up. There are other, you know, exterior shots.
Also, I want to
think that self-contained really helps him.
I want to just take quick umbrage with one of the things you said in your review about Lady in the Water. I don't think that was one of his worst films. That was decent M. Night.
I think that's where it started to go downhill.
Signs maybe is where it started, even though people always point to that as one of the good ones. Village, arguable. You like The Village.
I like The Village. I would actually say I was down on Signs and Lady in the Water, but like The Village. I think we can all agree that anyways, his two big ones were Unbreakable and The Sixth Sense.
Yeah.
And he hadn't quite touched that ever since, right? It's always been about those two films. That's like the high point of his career.
You know, and it's funny because we're talking about M. Night on this particular episode where we're discussing addiction, but it's funny that we're as moviegoers, we're chasing that original high, aren't we? We're trying to get back to that sixth sense, you know, like he was dead the whole time. Oh my God, you know, we're never going to get it again, people. It's over. He did it. It's done.
Well, the other thing, too, is I do believe to a degree what you're saying is he has this almost working against him. You're sitting there in the theater and you can almost feel people are trying to figure out what the twist is. And like I said, there is a really nice reveal here that a lot of people are going to be talking about. But it's not on that level of, oh, my God, he was dead the whole time where something was, you almost had to rewatch the entire film. Yeah. Nothing like that. It's more, it's just a reveal of something, you know, which is a nice touch, and I don't want to give it away in any way, but it's not nothing that changes the entire film in any way, like The Sixth Sense or anything on that level. It was just like a nice, all right, that's what he's known for, these reveals, and that was pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, prior to that reveal in The Sixth Sense, the best was, you know, Luke, I am your father. I mean, it's really second only to that. It might even be better than that.
Oh, no. Come on.
All right.
Let's not get ahead of ourselves here.
Let's get back on
topic. Scale it back down here, Matt.
Yeah. Right. Do you have a favorite scene of the film?
There was one scene in particular that was extremely well shot. And just looking at it was beautiful. There's a scene where the girls are sort of in the forefront of the shot looking down a hallway as McAvoy's character is coming at them, and he actually like sort of jumps on the wall and then starts climbing on pipes on the ceiling. Whoa. And as he's climbing on the pipes getting closer to them, he's knocking out all the lights as he crosses them, so it keeps getting darker down the hallway and he's walking down these pipes, and I mean in a fast motion, so it's he's going on these pipes so fast, bam, light out, bam, light out, and he keeps getting closer to them.
Holy
looked awesome.
Moly.
Really looked awesome.
Sounds really cool.
Enjoyed that shot.
Do you have any scene you had trouble with?
What would M. Night film be without an M. Night cameo? I do believe he left himself out of The Visit, but he is known for putting himself in the movies, and sometimes in The Lady in the Water, he actually had like a real role.
Pretty
right?
big role, yeah.
This is really more or less a cameo, but it's a small one, and it's just distracting. You know how sometimes it can be? And here he's just playing a surveillance camera guy that's helping the psychiatrist out. But even for that maybe 90 seconds that he's on screen, it's like, oh my God. Everybody has to be thinking, why did M. Night have to put himself in this movie? I hated that little scene.
Yeah, who does he think he is? Stan Lee?
Yeah.
And those are comedies usually, so, you know. Were there any movie influences you picked up on?
Two that I think you're going to relate to right away. 10 Cloverfield Lane, which we had just saw, you know, an abduction, and they're sort of in a bunker.
Because
a lot of the film does take place with these girls captured. And then also Identity. I don't know if you've seen this movie with John Cusack. If not, it's worth a rental.
You know,
it has to do with, you know, multiple personalities.
Okay.
So check that one out.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah. We've been having such a great deep conversation. I want to know, Ry, did you learn anything from this movie?
Yes, I learned something very, very deep. James McAvoy looks good in a dress. Okay. That one's a joke, but it did also present a new way at looking at...
At James McAvoy?
Yes.
In a dress?
In a dress. No, it did present a new way of looking at people who are damaged that may have went through something very dramatic.
Traumatic
in their life that now have a damaged mind or a damaged soul. It has a new spin, I think, when you take it away, like, wow, the way they presented that is interesting. You always look down on those people, and maybe they had something that actually shook them so much that it opened their mind to something different. Interesting.
So is M. Night back?
I wouldn't say back, but still on the road to recovery. This is definitely on, you know, it's almost like if you were on the top of the mountain and he fell off it, and now he started climbing back up. He's still on the right direction.
Okay.
Yeah.
So one word review, right? What is it?
Personality. This film's got personality.
Nice.
Little play on the words right there.
Nice.
As I said, 2.5 Jaws, 4 Split. And I'm excited to hear what people think of the little reveal at the end. Very interesting one. So there was no necessarily addiction in Split.
Mm-hmm.
But that is our topic this week because we have the wonderful Krisha Fairchild on from Krisha. And Matt, you're getting a start this week.
I am honored. Thank you.
And mind you, like I had mentioned a little while before, this can be any addiction movie at all. It doesn't have to be drugs or alcohol. So hit me. What's your number 5, buddy?
I honestly, most of mine, in fact, all of them I'm looking at my list are drugs or alcohol.
Okay.
So
that's fine.
That's just me. So at number 5, have you ever seen, I'm willing to bet the answer is no. Have you ever seen, Ryan, Beyond the Valley of the Dolls?
I have not seen it.
It is written by
Roger Ebert.
By the great Roger Ebert. Directed by the arguably great Russ Meyer, certainly noteworthy Russ Meyer. It is a singular movie. It's about sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Three starlets move to Los Angeles to seek their fame, and it quickly devolves into drugs, alcohol, and debauchery. And the ending of the movie is one of the more disturbing and brutal endings, especially for the time. But leading up to that is just pure 60s irreverence and camp. I mean, Austin Powers must have taken, you know, some nods or some cues from this film. So it's an absolute must for any camp fan.
I've always wanted to see it because they always sort of joke around, even if you've seen Life Itself in the Roger Ebert documentary, somewhere somebody jokes about him writing this film. So I've always been interested in checking it out.
If you see one Russ Meyer film, make it Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. And it's definitely a worthy film for this list.
Have you seen this one, Krisha?
Yeah. When it first came out, yes, of course. No, I'm just kicking myself that I didn't go with Valley of the Dolls. Darn.
The original, yeah.
Nice pick, Matt.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, we've got to start it with something different. I like that.
There's a lot of, you know, addiction in it. So
yeah, we swing it over to Krisha. What do you got sitting at number five?
Number five for me is Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf?
Ah, nice one.
Got all kinds of addiction, including being addicted to being cruel to someone you love.
Very true. You know, I've seen the play here at Steppenwolf, actually. I believe Tracy Letts, if you're familiar, actually was on the stage in that production. And I love the stage. And I mean, the movie, I mean, Elizabeth Taylor, yeah. Burton, I mean, it's the best. What a film.
Talk about verite, huh?
Yeah. Quality film right there. Swings it over to my number five. And I went gambling with my number five, and it was a remake. I have never seen the 1974 film, but I did see the Mark Wahlberg remake that came out in 2014. I'm speaking of The Gambler.
I like the remake.
I did very much, as I have it listed as my number five. Mark Wahlberg plays a college professor who is addicted to gambling and is in a large amount of debt to some underground gambling boss. And it ties into his
whole... I think he owes money all over town,
yeah,
really.
Yeah, everywhere. But it ties into where the underground gambling boss actually wants one of his students to throw a basketball game. And there's people that he knows that are in danger if he doesn't pay these guys back. Jessica Lange actually plays his mom in the film.
Oh, great performance.
Yeah, the music's great, cinematography great, good performances. And gambling, huge addiction that a lot of people struggle with. So
hey. That's a good pick, Rye. I like it.
Yeah. Have you seen it, Krisha?
I have not, but I have known people with the gambling addiction, and just like any other one, it is a bugger.
It is.
It is.
No doubt.
Yeah. That brings us to my number four, and I'm sticking with the oddballs here. I'm going straight to Naked Lunch.
Ooh.
1991 David Cronenberg movie. I absolutely love Peter Weller in this, and of course it's based on the William S. Burroughs novel of the same name, and man, is this a mind bender. It deals with a lot of topics, not the least of which is drug addiction. If you're into something strange, you want to see something really weird, even weirder, arguably, than Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, check out Naked Lunch.
Yeah, I would definitely agree. And it's way weirder than Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. I mean, it's way weirder. Images you can't shake.
Yeah. You know? I mean, it really takes someone like David Cronenberg to get weirder than Terry Gilliam, so.
Yes.
Yeah. And you know what, Krisha, you just said something there about images you can't shake. And I think that's very common in these particular movies when you're dealing with addiction. I don't know why, but a lot of the films when I was listing them had exactly what you say right there. Like, oh, man, there was something about that movie I could just never get out of my memory again. You know what I mean? Yeah. So
yep. I think we're going to get to a lot of those on this list.
I agree. What do you got sitting at four, Krisha?
Well, you know, this is a movie that completely shredded me when I saw it in the theater. I absolutely did not expect that. I don't care for Nicolas Cage, but Leaving Las Vegas just tore me into little bits the first time I saw it.
Yeah, what a performance. Yeah,
one of the images from that one, I don't know if you've seen it or not, but where he is in a swimming pool trying to drink alcohol while underwater.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's kind of a comical moment, but yeah, it's also harrowing, yeah.
It is. Yeah. And in fact, he comes out of the pool and then he falls backwards into like a glass table.
Yes.
They got to
yes.
pull the glass out of his back, and he's basically laughing, you know, yeah. I'm like a prickly pear. But I mean, it's just so... It's funny because you're laughing in some way because it's, you know, Nicolas Cage doing this performance, and at the same time it's so sad and
tragic,
harrowing.
Yeah.
Then
absolutely.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
The Nick Cage, I remember there, I thought, wow, this guy, he is on the fast track to doing nothing but just beautiful movies. And
that was not the case.
No, not the case.
Not so much.
Hit or miss with that guy.
He's got hits and misses, yeah.
He does. He always bounces back. Right when you think, like, wow, he's really off the rails, he'll come back with usually a pretty strong performance in something.
Yep.
So, yeah. Yeah. Nice pick at number four. My number four came out in 1991. I know for a fact I've never talked about this movie on all 310 episodes now of Cinemajaw. It stars Jennifer Jason Leigh and Jason Patrick. The film is entitled Rush.
Mmm.
Have you guys seen this one?
No.
What year?
This one came out in 1991.
No, I haven't seen it.
And this is where they both play like detectives that are trying to, you know, they're in disguise, undercover, trying to get down to the bottom of the sort of drug circle and catch the underground drug lord here. And to do so, they actually have to start taking drugs because they get in that situation where are you or aren't you an undercover cop kind of deal. And we've seen this presented in various movies. But in this one, I think it's so scary because there's that always that fear that if you were ever to, you know, be injected with drugs, that you may never be able to come back to, you know what I mean? You may just slip into that world. I think that's what, you know, a lot of people, it happens to a lot of people. And I think that's what a lot of people fear that would happen. And that's exactly what happens to these two police officers that go undercover to do the right thing. And then
become addicts themselves.
And become addicts themselves. Oh, just, I don't know why. Just always, it almost frightened me, the movie, you know, but in a good way. And Rush, I was always a big fan. My number four.
All right. Swings it over to my number three. And at number three, I actually had Leaving Las Vegas. I agree with you, Krisha. It's absolutely devastating. If I had to throw in a quick sub that just missed my top five, I would say Less Than Zero, a young Robert Downey. It's sort of the Brat Pack of the day doing an odd movie out of left field. And I just found out this is based on the novel by, what's his name? Easter Ellis. Is that his name? No, Brett Ellis.
Easton Ellis.
Yes, yeah. Thank you. He wrote American Psycho. I did not know this.
Oh, I didn't know either.
Less Than Zero is an amazing movie, so highly recommend it.
Nice. Krisha, what do you got sitting at number three?
This was a pivotal one for me when I was going out into the world and thought the world was such a cool and groovy kind of place. And I saw this movie and had a little more respect for substances and Midnight Cowboy. I don't know if you've seen it, you know, Dustin Hoffman and
I'm walking here.
Angelina's dad. And wow, just an amazing, amazing bummer. For anybody who thought that they were going to move to New York and like live in the loft scene and do all kinds of drugs and, you know, be in an Andy Warhol movie.
Mm-hmm.
Bummer.
Yeah. It seemed like they were making such interesting movies. They are still today, but there's something fond about looking back at that time. I believe that was the first movie that was that rated X, was it not?
It was. Yes, it was.
Yeah. It was rated X and it won the Academy Award for Best Picture, I believe.
Yeah.
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 Amazing. Yeah. What
is that
picture.
The only X-rated film to ever
throw it in the jaw box? Yeah. Elias likes to look up these facts. Throw it in the jaw box. Make sure. Swings it over to my number three. And what would a top five list be, Matt, without a Leo DiCaprio film? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, right. And when you're talking Leo DiCaprio and you're talking addiction,
you're talking what's eating Gilbert Grape.
Wouldn't that be crazy? Addicted to food. And
there's
you could
a food addiction.
There,
you could.
There is. True, right? But no, I am going darker. And one of Leo's, I think this was DiCaprio's performance. He was awesome in What's Eating Gilbert Grape, but he was a little bit younger at that point, and you never know if that's a fluke, right?
Sure.
But in 1995, I think with The Basketball Diaries, he proved it was no fluke.
Fair to say he arrived.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this movie, I don't know. I mean, I was probably in high school, maybe when I saw this movie, and I remember just being I was stunned, how good of an actor he was at the time.
It's and a stunning movie,
He plays Jim Carroll, who the diaries were based on this guy's story of growing up in New York. He's playing basketball, and he slips down the slippery slope and doesn't have a father figure in his life and starts doing heroin and cocaine. And then those just heartbreaking scenes of DiCaprio outside of his mom's door crying, trying to get in, and her having to lock the door on her own son, thinking that maybe she's doing what's best for him or doesn't know what to do. Again, coming back to like Krisha's film, Krisha, it's one of those films that we say is comforting, because I think there's a lot of people battling addiction on both sides that don't know what to do with someone who's having struggles like that. That scene in particular, crushing, and then also his withdrawal scenes when they finally do get him clean are spectacular. The basketball diaries, we don't talk about it much on the show. One of DiCaprio's best, I think. You guys have seen it?
No.
I've seen it. It's great. Yeah, Krisha, you need to check this one out. Definitely.
I will.
Yeah. So that was my number three. I'm sure most of the jawheads have seen it, but if you haven't, put it on the queue. It's most worthy of a watch.
Agree. All right. So that brings us to our number twos. And at number two, I have a 1987 film, Faye Dunaway, Mickey Rourke, and inspired by Charles Bukowski, Barfly.
Mm. One I still have not seen.
Now, this one we can maybe argue about which side it takes on addiction, because I think Bukowski in general was completely unapologetic up to the very end. And we can definitely get philosophical on you know, whether he was justified or correct. But this movie is absolutely moving, and I think at least the movie takes a stance as to how destructive and terrible and hollow the lifestyle is. Faye Dunaway's performance, absolutely amazing. And Mickey Rourke, too. I mean, let's not forget, this guy was tremendous at a time before all the plastic surgery and stuff. And this film is probably one of the greatest examples of really of both of their work. And it's just,
I think so, too. And I think also the use of celebrities in roles where you have an expectation of that celebrity, and then the role is just it's a naked strip of not who you're expecting them to be, you know?
Yeah, agreed. Especially from Faye Dunaway. I mean, Mickey Rourke, maybe we can expect that a little, but she was just transformed. Good movie. Great movie.
Wow. Strong list you got going here, Matt.
Thank you.
Yeah. Very addictive. Well,
when I look at my number two, I you know, there are a couple that I'll tell you that I rejected. Uh-huh. I rejected Requiem for a Dream. It's an amazing film about addiction. It was so difficult for me to watch that I never finished watching it.
It's a tough one.
I don't feel that I could say that. I know a lot of people might have expected me somewhere in my list to have Woman Under the Influence, the amazing Jenna Rollins in a Cassavetes film. I actually have only seen that when it first came out, when I lived in L.A., and people kind of likened my performance in Krisha a little bit to her, and I barely remember it. Now that all of the Krisha stuff is done, I intend to go back and see it. But the one I'm going to go with for number two is a movie that was made in 1945. And I think it was Hollywood's best effort at the issue of addiction first, and that's Lost Weekend with Ray Milland. This is a guy who is fighting the demons, and he's locked himself in his apartment for a weekend to try to beat it. And he goes in the DTs, and I mean, we are talking, you know, spiders on the walls and every kind of bad kind of a thing that you can imagine trying to kick. And sure. I didn't see it, of course, when it first came out. I saw it later in my 20s and was I thought it still stood up.
Wow. You know, I think what's interesting, too, is we do our what we call our research or our homework for the show. And this was a film that came up as I was doing it. And I realized, man, I got to write this one down and put it on my queue because I haven't seen it. So I already have this one written down just from researching addiction movies. I'm excited to see Lost Weekend.
Yeah.
Good pick.
Yeah, it is a good
pick. Nice pick at number two. Mine at number two came out in 2011, and I believe, obviously, Matt, we were already doing the show by 2011.
We were.
This was my number one movie of the year in 2011.
Huh.
And this is...
We're going back a little ways here. I don't know if I can remember.
This is a Michael Fassbender movie.
Oh, I do remember now.
And this has to do with sex addiction. Mm-hmm. I am speaking of the wonderful, I mean, just gorgeous masterpiece by Steve McQueen, Shame. Carey Mulligan is also in this film. And I mean, I think it, as I wrote in my notes here, sexual addiction finally shown in a real and honest way. Fassbender plays Brandon, the lead. Him and Carey Mulligan are brother and sister, and she comes to live with him for a time. And he is clearly addicted to sex. He's either watching porn or calling on prostitutes or trying to hook up with people at all times. And There's definitely, they allude to a past that something happened to them, probably by their parents, maybe a father or something, and that they're not wrong people. But I think there's something so interesting there for the first time seeing it on film, that feeling of shame that he has after every experience, that he has this drive to do something, does it, follows through with it, and then that shame that he feels afterwards for having that addiction. That he has. The performance by Fassbender is great. The direction by McQueen's awesome. The music's great. It really is just a masterpiece of a film.
This is one I still need to catch up with, Rye.
Yeah. Have you seen it by chance, Krisha?
No, you know, I haven't. And I was asking myself why, and I think it's that by 2011, my family was so deeply enmeshed in our own story of addiction. I don't think I wanted to see many movies about addiction.
Yeah, understandable. Yeah, but do seek out Shame for the Jawheads and people who have not seen it. Wonderful film, so love it.
All right.
These are our big ones,
Here
Matt.
We go. All right, you know, it would be easy to put Darren Aronofsky's Requiem for a Dream here at number one. It would be very easy. I think, like you were saying, Krisha, it's a very difficult film to watch, but just a fantastic masterpiece of a movie. I didn't go there. I went with Flight instead. Denzel Washington's portrayal of an alcoholic just came across so honest. There's some gonzo sort of exaggerated things in there with John Goodman's character and the cocaine and stuff like that. But when he's facing down his demons, and there's this moment in the film where you really believe that he's cleaned up his act, and I don't want to spoil anything, but I mean, we do know that he's an addict and he's going to let you down at some point. And it's just harrowing because as a viewer, you're watching this temptation and you think he's beaten it and you're like so proud of him. And then he succumbs and you're just devastated as a viewer. And it was such an effective moment, the likes of which I have not seen. And I think in that moment, they captured what it is to be an addict better than any of the films on this list.
That tortured soul, right? That just...
Just how he couldn't say no to it.
Yeah.
You know, he had to go back to the alcohol.
I love it. Yeah, it was a great one. That was.
I have to put that on my list because I love Denzel and I have not seen it.
Oh, it's a good one.
It's
really good.
Yeah, Robert Zemeckis directed it and he does great work. Yeah,
I always love him. Yeah.
great pick at number one. Krisha, what do you got sitting there?
Well, okay, I'm going to go light, but I'm going to explain why. When you grow up in the 60s and Cocktails, you know, just think Mad Men and then just move it forward a decade. These people are a decade older. Cocktails are a part of everything all around you. My parents had cocktails. They partied with people that had cocktails. It was a very big part of everybody's social life. But I can vividly remember when I first saw Days of Wine and Roses. It's Jack Lemmon and Lee Remick, and I'm watching the movie and I'm going along and it's like, oh, they're like my parents. They're like my parents and their friends. And then when it started to turn within their relationship and when the addiction started to really take over, it was the very first time in my life that I questioned the place that alcohol played in society. So see what I mean? It's kind of a lightweight because it's just about people who have cocktails, a few too many cocktails, but it isn't. It's about the sneakiness of any addiction where you are justifying it and you're defending it and you're in denial. And then one day someone who loves you looks at you and they just can't do it any longer with you. And that's the way that movie affected me. It created a radar for me.
Sure. Wow. Like it. I like a story like that on a number one, right?
I do, yeah.
Yeah, boy, Krisha brings the goods.
No doubt.
Yeah. Now I feel like a fool with my number one pick.
What you got?
Yeah.
What you got, Rye? Lay it on us.
How couldn't somebody, out of three people, have Requiem for a Dream?
Oh, yeah. It belongs here, man. Yeah, it does.
In fact, me and Matt, when you know, we go back and forth, you know, with notes saying like, what do we want to do for the top five? When we said addiction movies, this was such a heavyweight that we had to pick one or the other to say, do you want it or do I? Or yeah. I just said, I'm going to take Requiem for a Dream.
Honest to God, no, it would have been my number one as well.
Yeah, Ellen Bernstein. I always say, I mean, she burned out of the Oscar. What an absolutely marvelous performance. Jared Leto, Jennifer Connelly, and you see the addiction from all of these characters, and I think yes. that's part of the beauty of the film is seeing these three characters who are obviously of different backgrounds and at different stages of their lives, but are all suffering from addiction. And I took down a couple of notes because I dove into this and I thought, I want to say something that I haven't said about this movie before. And a couple of things that I did pull up here is that the about the style of the movie that makes it so effective is the way that Aronofsky obviously presents the film, and it's extremely short shots throughout the film, Matt. While an average 100 minute film has 600 to 700 cuts, Requiem for a Dream features more than 2,000.
Jesus.
Split screen is used extensively, along with extremely tight close-ups. The average scene length of the film shortens as the film progresses. It begins with around 90 seconds to 2 minute long scenes until the movie climactic scene, which are cut together very rapidly, many changes per second, and accompanied by a score which increases in intensity accordingly. And I think that the vibe of the entire movie feels like we are addicted and the fear of addiction. And I think that's why so many people don't like to ever rewatch this movie, right? You watch it once and it's not just the story, but it's the way the movie is presented that gives us that almost fear of addiction.
How many times
if
have
I
you
could
seen
just
it?
Interject, I have to say that one of the reasons that I was not able to complete it is I really felt like I was having an acid flashback. Mm-hmm. I mean, I really, it viscerally affected me physically and viscerally in a way that, and I realize now when you tell me the numbers on the editing and everything that it was a physical, I was having a physical reaction that made me feel as though, oh my God, the acid I did in college. Oh my God. I could not physically finish it.
Yeah. I
some of the content and the subject matter is harrowing as well, Krisha. Yeah. It'll put you right off.
There's very few films where I just have to take a shower afterwards, and this was one of them. I mean, it was like, I remember I watched it, and I was like sweaty. I remember just my body physically was just sweaty from watching it. I was like, I'm just going to take a shower and go to bed and try to relax because I was just tense from watching the film.
So how many times have you seen it?
I've probably seen it now 3 or 4 times.
Wow. Yeah, just the once for me. But you know what? It's been too long. I think I'm due for a revisit.
What is interesting, because I also have seen Life of Pi as his first film, it is interesting watching those two, not Life of Pi, I'm sorry, just Pi. Yeah, just Pi.
Pi.
Yeah, to watch those two close together, how similar they are as far as style of how he shot the films and the quick boom, boom, boom edits. Very similar. So it is interesting. Honorable mentions really quick before we go to break. I did have Trainspotting.
Sure.
Don John, which was a little bit lighter affair with Joseph Gordon-Levitt, addicted to porn. One of my favorite movies that I adore Richard Dreyfuss, and he made one of the best comedies about gambling, Let It Ride, where he just keeps letting it ride at the racetrack. Hysterical. Love that movie. And Flight was also... Oh, and Smash with the guy who played Jesse in Breaking Bad.
Oh,
Aaron Paul, great indie film to check out. Also, Maria Winstead. Look up her name, Maria something.
Sure,
Winstead. Yeah, she's in there as well. She's in 10 Cloverfield Lane, but wonderful indie film. How about yourself, Matt?
I'm going to throw them out rapid fire. Traffic, Scarface, Wolf of Wall Street, Sid and Nancy.
Krisha?
Oh, Sid and Nancy was definitely on my backups. And I everything else that was on my backup, one or the third of us has touched on.
Good deal.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Jawheads, if we missed your favorite movie about addiction and you have Twitter pulled up, shoot us a tweet at Cinemajaw. We will retweet it and get the discussion going. What we're going to do is take a quick break. When we come back, Matt is taking Krisha on in Matthew McConaughey movie trivia, plus a CinemaWAR looking at who is the greatest movie hippie of all time. We'll be right back on Cinemajaw.
Let's go.
Let's all go to the lobby. Cinemajaw is brought to you by Horror Movie Yearbook. Horror Movie Yearbook is the latest podcast from the Midwest Podcast Network. In each episode, hosts Tim Long and Willie Gibbs discuss three horror films from a particular year and their context in the events of that year. Other topics include theoretical horror movie theme park rides, legal representation, and arguments for horror movie antiheroes, and much, much more. Find new episodes every other Friday on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn, or at horrormovieyearbook.com. And we thank them for their support. And by K&N Air Filters. Hey, Rye, it's cold out there, man. It's the middle of winter.
Sure is. Hope your car's running okay.
I just went to the mechanic and got my tire pressure, battery, and a new air filter.
Good idea, right? Yep. Change your oil and get a new air filter. And what better air filter to get than K&N?
They are the best. They're longtime supporters of Cinemajaw, and they have one of the best air filters on the market. It will increase your horsepower and the performance of your car. We recommend them highly. And hey, guys, if you go to knfilters.com/podcast, you will also get a free hat.
I love my K&N hat.
I do too. Keeps me warm in these cold winter months. And hey, we thank them for their support. To get ourselves a
treat. And we are back on Cinemajaw, hanging out here with Krisha Fairchild, who has called in from Mexico. One of the things I wanted to ask you about making Krisha that we did not get a chance to ask was the house where it was filmed. Was that family owned?
Yeah, that was Trey's mother's house, yes. He had been living while he was traveling around and working for Terrence Malick, and he was living at home to save money in his early 20s. Not an unfamiliar road for a lot of young filmmakers. And he knew every inch of the house. He knew exactly what time of day the light hit which windows. He knew where the shadows fell. When the cinematographer walked onto the set, he's just walking him around, showing him, and we'll film this scene at 4 p.m. And da, 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 da. And the cinematographer goes like, wow, I mean, like, how do you know this house so well? It's like, see that bedroom right there? My girlfriend and our three cats, we live there.
That is awesome. Because I think one of the great things that we're at a point now is that young talents like Trey, for instance, can muster up some money together and really showcase their talents, because doing like a one location shoot like that is so key to keep money down, and it's just amazing.
Pretty smart.
It sure is.
Very smart.
Yeah. Again, Krisha, for the jawheads listening to this, I again urge you to watch Krisha. It is streaming on Amazon Prime or available for rental. I'm sure Elias, when he jumps out of the jaw box, will have all those details. But if they want to follow along with you, Krisha, on Twitter and Facebook, the best place to do so is?
I think it's just Krisha Fairchild. There might be a dot in there somewhere. If they, you know, they can find me.
Yeah. If they Google you, they will find you.
Yeah.
I did want to mention, I always keep track of my favorite images of 2016, Krisha. And so you know, you did make my top 10 of that closing shot of just your face at the end of Krisha. I loved it. What was that like seeing it on the big screen? Was it like pretty shocking?
It was terrifying. It was actually terrifying to do it, because, you know, we did the opening and then the closing, and I won't ruin it for anybody by saying it. There's kind of different versions of a similar shot. Mm-hmm. And it was some of the hardest work that I did, because I didn't want to show. I didn't want there to be an answer in either shot. I didn't want someone to think, oh, I know what this movie's about. Even at the end, I didn't want them to know how it was all going to shake out. We leave it open. And mm-hmm. As an optimist, I have my opinion of what happens when this family gathering is over. And I very often at Q&As ask people, and sometimes they come up with things that I just am absolutely shocked at what they say. But that was difficult, because neutral is not a good acting word for me.
Well, it was perfect. I mean, the way you're describing it there is the way I saw it, and worked very effectively.
So, thank you.
Yeah, wonderful. Matt, before we get to trivia, mm-hmm. before we get to CinemaWAR, we did throw a few items into the jawbox.
We did. And,
you know, Elias, he's an addictive type. He loves the jawbox.
Yeah.
If he wasn't addicted to the jawbox, he would have left us by now.
He's addicted to looking up facts.
No doubt. So, heck, let's open up that jawbox.
What's your pleasure, Mr. Cotton?
The box.
We got a box! Oh, what's in the box?
How's it going, fellas? You know, this has been a great episode to be able to listen to through the porthole in the Jawbox. It's been such an amazing interview. Krisha, I feel like you just said that Trey's three cats lived in a room in that house.
Yes, they did.
That's awesome.
And okay, quick. When I was upstairs dabbing my lips with scotch and singing Bob Dylan at the top of my voice, the three cats were lined up at the bed as if they were watching a tennis match, watching me walk this way, watching me walk this way, watching me walk.
Nice.
They were totally creeped out.
Oh, wow. I'm a huge fan of cats. I couldn't let that slip by us. So let's just jump right into the questions now. Where else can you watch Krisha online? That is on all the major services like YouTube, iTunes, Vudu, Google Play. You could rent it for $3.99, starting at $3.99. That's a great price.
Do it. Absolutely.
In Smashed, what was the actress's name? Mary Elizabeth Winstead.
Mary Elizabeth Winstead. I knew it was a three-namer and I couldn't remember it. But wonderful actress, like I said, also in 10 Cloverfield Lane.
And Matt, just to clarify, you asked about the other X-rated films nominated? Or
I said, were there any?
Okay, yes. So Midnight Cowboy was the only X-rated film to win an Oscar in any category, and one of three films nominated for an Oscar, the others being Stanley Kubrick's A Clockwork Orange, and unfortunately, from what we learned about the film recently, Last Tango in Paris.
Hmm.
Wow.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Very
See
interesting.
How he gets these facts?
Yeah, he's fascinating, dude.
Yeah.
Right.
All that with no internet.
And no cats. The keeping company.
Elias, yes. Elias, for this trivia thing, can we work a deal, babe? Because I'm horrible at trivia. So I'll tell you what, you know my email, right?
Yeah.
So,
oh, okay.
If you can just like shoot me I swear nobody will ever know.
Was that everything in the Jawbox?
Yeah. Yes.
All right. Yes. Get back in there. Matt, it brings us to a segment called
CinemaWAR.
CinemaWAR works like this. Me and Matt, we battle on a topic. Our guest, Krisha, she gets to play judge and jury and tell the Jawheads who she thinks won the CinemaWAR. And it's important because we're fighting for 20 seconds of jaw time to rant and rave on whatever we want. Wow. We have Krisha, a self-proclaimed hippie on the show. Elias, tell the Jawheads at home what today's CinemaWAR topic is.
Today's CinemaWAR topic, who is the better hippie in movies? The dude from The Big Lebowski or Tommy Chong from Cheech and Chong? Right, you'll be fighting for the dude. Matt, you'll be fighting for Tommy Chong. Let's let this CinemaWAR begin.
Hey, man. This one's for all the little Lebowskis. The dude has the laid-back attitude that is just right to be called the best hippie in Hollywood. While Cheech and Chong were making fun of the lifestyle, the dude was living it.
All right, listen, I love the dude, love him, but he is no Tommy Chong, man. Tommy had the nice dreams that went up in smoke with Cheech. The dude is more about the white Russians. He's more of a lazy bum than a hippie.
Ah, the look alone should win me this argument. The dude, Jeff Bridges with long hair, sunglasses, and a bathrobe, hippie perfection.
Well, that's like your opinion, man. And all the dude-isms were also first uttered by Chong, decades before the man. In fact, we may owe the use of the word man as part of speech completely to Tommy Chong, man. Plus, his name rhymes with bong.
I get it, man. I get it, man. Cheech and Chong were cool dudes back in the day. But I'm the dude, dude. If anyone else tried to say a line like that, it would not work. But in the hands of Lebowski, it fits just perfectly.
Look, at the end of the day, the dude goes home, takes off the cardigan, and puts on some cowboy boots, and he's Jeff Bridges, the guy from Tron and Starman and the villain in the first Iron Man movie. When Tommy Chong goes home or to jail, he's still Tommy Chong. He lives it. He's the real deal, man, not some semi-fictional creation.
Stop saying man, man.
I won't stop,
and
man.
Stop bringing up Iron Man, man. The white Russians, the psychedelic trip that he takes holding his bowling ball as he floats through the sky, the friends he has, the problems he's involved in. Lebowski is the ultimate movie hippie. It is Jeff Bridges' best role, and that is saying a ton.
Here's the bottom line. Tommy Chong was the voice of a generation. Through his comedy and activism, he has stood up for and even been incarcerated for fighting for the legalization of marijuana. The dude was based on a shiftless bowler with little to no aspirations in life. Stoner vibe aside, the flower power generation actually stood for something too. Peace and love, man. The dude is too into himself. I mean, he calls himself the dude. Come on. Tommy Chong is the better specimen of hippie.
Wow. Wow. We are button heads here, as we do each and every week on CinemaWAR. We throw it to our guest, our jury. Krisha, what did you think of this CinemaWAR? How was it for you?
Well, first of all, I should have recused myself because I was a hippie and I, you know, I have some very strong opinions. I think you both did a great job. I think hands down, if you ask me who argued better, I'd say it was, you know, close to a tie. If you ask me who made the best case for what I know to be true about hippies, I would have to say that the dude is the dude, and Tommy Chong was a joke. He was like other people laughing at us. Okay, if the van's knocking, don't rock and don't be knocking. I mean, he was like making fun of the trip that we were on.
I told you.
And also, I lived in Hawaii a long time, and so I got the distinct pleasure of seeing him pimping head shops in Waikiki that he owned. So that's not cool, man. Not cool. So the dude is like, yes. I mean, look at the people he hung with. Let's just go with that. You know, I mean, Dave was never there for Tommy Chong, right? But the dude, the bowling team, Jesus, come on. You know, no, I'm sorry.
I love it.
The white Russians aside, Jeff Bridges and the dude were the definitive what happens to a hippie after they're washed up.
Wow, I thought I had that one, too.
I was worried because right before we started recording, she said she had a definitive idea right off the bat as we were telling her what the topic was. I thought, uh-oh.
Like you say, I should have recused, but you gave me the job.
Good.
And so I admit that I was prejudiced.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll take a win anytime I can get a win, man.
It's really tough to beat the dude, you know, any day of the week. So
yeah,
I would agree.
Yeah. No doubt about it. I'll take this 20 seconds to, I wanted to talk to the Jawheads really quick about some of the smaller gems like Krisha, the film, that we're talking about today. There were a lot of smaller films. I mean, some are a little bit bigger, like Age of 17, but other films, smaller ones that are now rolling out, one of them being Love and Friendship, also out on Amazon Prime that you can catch. I love this movie as well. There's so many smaller films, so please do me a favor. Look around. I know we go a lot of blockbusters all the time, but look around. There's some smaller films out there streaming that need some attention, need some call to attention. You know what I mean?
Well done.
There you go. That's all I want.
All right.
Just like Krisha, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right.
I want more people watching smaller films, man. Is that such a bad thing?
No.
No. That's all.
I respect it, Ryan. I respect it.
I don't ask too much.
I bet you Tommy Chong would agree.
Yeah, there you go. All right. In honor of the movie Gold opening up in a week, starring Matthew McConaughey, no better time than the play. Matthew McConaughey movie trivia. It works like this. Krisha, you're our guest. You get to choose if you want to go first or let Matt go first. There are steals if the opponent doesn't know it. And if you get hung up on any question, you get one trip to the ER. Elias Rodriguez, our engineer, has clues to all the questions. Krisha, what do you want to do? Go first? They do start easy, Krisha. I will let you know.
I don't even know if clues would help me in this. I have a 66-year-old brain. Let me just start with that. I think...
Go first. I agree.
I think I better go first because otherwise he's going to just totally wipe me.
I don't know. Trust me, I suck.
All right. Uh-huh. Here we go. Krisha, question number one, Matthew McConaughey movie trivia. Here we go. Matthew McConaughey won the Oscar for Best Actor in 2013... Name the film.
Shoot. Drug dealer. He lost a lot of weight. He was really skinny.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, I didn't see it. Yeah,
It might have a city in Texas name in there.
It's not. No.
And it's not Austin. A little north of Austin.
Oh, Dallas Buyers Club.
Krisha is on the board. Krisha is on the board. 1-0. No help from the host, as you can see. Question 2 over to Matt K. Matt, McConaughey has appeared in 1 Christopher Nolan directed film. It came out in 2014. Name it. He is looking up to the sky.
It wasn't one of the Batman movies,
no,
right?
No, it was not.
Jesus. McConaughey in a Christopher Nolan film came out in
2014.
Oh, man. This is where... See, Krisha, I told you. The people are screaming at their phones and...
The first two questions are supposed to be layups, to give you an idea.
Yeah. Well, I don't know it either, so good luck.
2014.
Oh, my God.
I know. I should know this.
What is with Matt? We getting another poster ready here, Elias?
Oh, yes.
Sahara. I have no idea.
Wow.
I know I'm going to kick myself on this.
You're asinine sometimes, I tell you. We've talked about this so many times. All right. We throw it over to Krisha. You do have a chance for a steal here, Krisha. Christopher Nolan directed, Matthew McConaughey starred in it, came out in 2014. Any guess?
No, I got nada.
Interstellar.
Yeah.
Interstellar. Jeez. Wow.
Yeah. Blew that one.
It's only been mentioned 100 times on Cinemajaw.
I really enjoyed the film too. Just, I'm suck at trivia.
Yeah. Krisha, question 3 is over to you. Matthew McConaughey starred in another gold film entitled Fool's Gold, in which a couple try to find a lost treasure. What actress starred alongside him as his wife in the film? Matthew McConaughey and who in Fool's Gold? You can just take a guess on an actress if you don't know.
I definitely don't know. And well, I know it wasn't Kate Hudson, but I'll just throw a name out. Kate Hudson.
That's correct.
No, you're kidding. No.
Wow.
I thought when you say that you were going to go away from it, I thought, oh no, stick with Kate Hudson. Absolutely. Oh,
that, I mean, that literally was a wild guess.
Sometimes you just throw a dart with your eyes closed and you hit the bullseye somehow.
Good stuff. It is now 2-0, Krisha. Question 4 over to Matt K. Matt, McConaughey got his big break in 1993 with Dazed and Confused. Mm-hmm. Who wrote and directed that film?
That's Cameron Crowe.
Incorrect, Matt.
Richard Linklater.
Oh my God.
Oh, Jesus.
3-0, Krisha. It's a slaughter at this point. I love it.
Oh, I was thinking Almost Famous.
Makes me happier. Wow. Hey, she's a voice actor. I don't know if this lends to it, but question 5 is over to her. Krisha, McConaughey actually lended his voice to 2 animated films in 2016. Name both films.
Whoa, both. God, was one that Fox thing? Both. No, I got nothing.
Matt, you got a chance for a steal and to get on the board.
All right, I know for a fact one of them was Kubo and the Two Strings, and the other animated film, it was not Moana. Was it the Pixar movie? I don't. No, that was. Our editor, Phil, who's a huge animation fan, is like literally casting me his looks here.
Yeah, no help, Phil.
I'll go ahead and say Zootopia because I'm not sure. I got it wrong, Phil?
Yes, and you reviewed the movie on the show here, Sing.
Sing? Oh, yeah. That's right. See, it doesn't sound like McConaughey.
It was your review, and you didn't get that right. He is one of a kind.
I'm one of a kind.
He's going easy on me.
No, I'm not. That's the sad thing.
It is still 3-1, Krisha. Question 6 now is over to Matt K. Matt, Matthew has starred in 1 directed Robert Zemeckis film. It came out in 1997 and starred Jodie Foster along with him. Name the film.
Man, I guess you know what? I'll just go to the ER on this one.
Whoa, a trip
I'm having
a
bad day.
Question number 6, Elias Rodriguez. What was the name of that Robert Zemeckis directed film?
Your clue is a lens you put in your eye to help sight.
Contact.
Yes.
What have you got that one, Krisha?
I knew it, Matt. I was right on your tail.
Oh, ooh, I picked a good time to use my ER then.
All right. He is on the board finally. It is 3-1 now. It is 3-1. All right. Question 7. She can win it right here. Right here, because there's only 8 questions. Krisha, McConaughey has starred in only one film with the great Jennifer Lopez. Name this clunker.
Oh,
Jennifer Lopez and Matthew McConaughey. You do have a trip to the ER if you need it.
Yeah, because I'm going to need it because I can see her in a bathtub. And
I know this one. I totally know this
one. Like a heisty kind of thing or the...
Whoa, a trip to the ER.
Okay, I'm going to the ER.
All right, yes. Question number 7, Elias Rodriguez. What was the name of that Jennifer Lopez, Matthew McConaughey film?
Your clue is, helps the bride and groom to be.
Wedding Planner.
Totally knew that one.
Of course it did.
How does it feel, buddy? Oh, wow.
Krisha is going to win this one. It is 4-1, but last question of the game over to you, Matt K. Matt, name the 2005 film that starred McConaughey, Al Pacino, and Rene Russo and was about sports gambling.
Oh, man.
Al Pacino. Uh-huh. You know him.
I do.
Matthew McConaughey.
Is it Any Given Sunday?
Incorrect.
Oh, I know it. God
nope,
damn
nope,
it.
Nope, nope,
it
nope.
does have a day of the week in the title.
Nope. Still wrong.
Oh.
Nope. Krisha, any guess here? You've already won, but you can just add on here by chance.
I got nothing. Zip.
Two for the money.
Huh.
Was that Matthew McConaughey, Al Pacino film?
Never heard of it. Would never have guessed it.
Doesn't matter, Krisha. You won this one 4-1. Big winner here, of course, Krisha. If it came down to a tie, we call it a jawbreaker. The question would have been to you, Krisha. What is Matthew McConaughey better known for? Driving a Lincoln or saying, all right, all right, all right?
All right, all right, all right.
Yeah, we'd give her that one, right?
Sometimes both at the same time, though.
Yeah.
Yes.
The real jawbreaker, that was just a joke. The real jawbreaker is this. Age of Al Pacino, closest to. Matt, you got to guess.
Al Pacino, the devil himself. I would say he is, I'd say he's got to be in his 60s by now. I would say 60... I'm going to go in the middle, 65.
Elias, lock him in at 65. Mm-hmm. Krisha, you got a guess?
Oh, boy. I think he's actually a little older than I would go like 67.
Flip those around. He's actually 76.
Oh.
Whoa.
76 for Al Pacino. Yeah.
He looks great. He's doing
he
good.
He sure does. We should all look so good, huh?
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Virtual handshake. Krisha does win this one 4-1. Well done, Krisha.
Wow.
Virtual handshake.
She won, and I didn't even have to email her the answers. That's
no.
Great.
Oh, that's how she did it. Jesus.
You know, it brings us to the end of a great jaw. And I'm addicted to doing the jaw. I love doing it. So I'm always sad when they come to an end.
I am too. And you know what? That's a healthy addiction, right?
It is. Yeah. First and foremost, we got to thank our guests. This was an honor. Krisha, thank you so much for coming on Cinemajaw.
Thank you, guys. I really enjoyed it.
Back at you, for sure.
Yeah. Matt, we also got to thank our sponsors.
Yes. Thanks to all the sponsors and the Chicago Podcast Co-op who help us get those sponsors.
We also got to thank the best engineer in the biz, Elias Rodriguez.
Thank you, fellas.
If you like this episode of Cinemajaw, please subscribe to us on iTunes. If you already do, leave us a review. Those reviews help attract new listeners.
Yes. Please go on our Facebook and also send us some feedback at feedback@cinemajaw.com.
And if you guys like pictures, we know you do. Check us out on Instagram. We are at Cinemajaw.
We are at Cinemajaw on Twitter as well. Heck, we are at Cinemajaw everywhere on social media. Until next week, I'm Ry, the movie guy.
I'm Matt K. And keep on jawing about the movies.